G'day, it is good to be back. It is good to be home. Yeah, let's see here. We'll get it off mute. We love this church. We love being here. We love the opportunity to let you know of the good things God is doing and has done. There is no doubt in our mind of places that we prefer to be. And let me open in prayer, and then we'll look at a couple of verses, and we want to talk a little bit about what God has been doing. Thank you, Lord, so much for this day. It's a day that you have made, and we are going to rejoice and be glad in it, regardless of all of the commotion going on in our life, regardless of how we see our nation, regardless of the turmoil in our world. This day is an opportunity set aside to gather together with your people, to worship you in spirit and in truth, as we study your word, as we sing songs, as we fellowship with one another and give praise for what you have done and are doing. Lord, we want you to be magnified. We want you to be lifted up. This day is about you. Thank you for the opportunity before us now in this hour. In Christ's name, amen. Have you a recent experience where you were going through your devotions and felt like all of a sudden God took a ball peen hammer and smacked you in the head? Every once in a while that happens. I have my devotions every day. I love reading the Word of God. And every once in a while something will just hit you so hard that it really kind of jumps off the page at you, and you can't stop going back and looking at it that day, maybe, or several days after. And I had one of those recently, found in Psalm 126. Psalm 126 is just a short psalm. It's only 6 verses long, divided easily into 2 different paragraphs. I understand that many people in this world will take this and they'll skew it all out of Scripture and they'll make it into a wealth and prosperity gospel. Let me say this morning, first up, there is nothing that I have seen hurt people more than the wealth and prosperity gospel. In all of the different ministry I have had, I have seen it devastate people over and over again. I am not a wealth and prosperity gospel guy. I'm going to preach a passage they like, or I'm going to talk about a passage they like, but it's not because I'm preaching prosperity gospel. Okay? This is a spiritual book meant for spiritual things. Lift your minds with me this morning as we look at Psalm 126. Verse 1 says, When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongues with shouts of joy. Then they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. We are glad. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like streams in the Negev. Those who sow in tears shall reap with shouts of joy. He who goes out weeping, bearing the seeds for sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, bringing his sheaves with him. It's a fairly short passage, isn't it? And yet it is a wonderful, wonderful passage. I wonder this morning, as you think of God, are you thinking great thoughts of joy? Even shouts of joy? When you think of celebrating the gospel together with the church this morning, is what is on your heart, your mouth, filled with laughter? So often we think of the importance of the gospel. Yes, it is. But it is to be celebrated. The gospel is powerful. It changes lives. It does wonderful things to those who come to God, not on their terms, on his terms. We have been so privileged to be your missionaries and see God do precisely that. Some of you were around back in late 1992 when we first came here. You realize how long ago that was? That was 32 years ago. And this church has partnered with us ever since. While it took us another 2 years to get out to the field for the first time, God has been so gracious to us. So gracious to give us a ministry because he's done a ministry in our heart, in our life. I am very grateful to say I'm not the same man I was 32 years ago. God has done a wonderful work on me, in me, through me. During that time, we've seen so many come to Christ. Even on Prefield, I made that our goal, was as we were going around to preach Christ and to find opportunities in the different churches to go out and Pastor Smith back in those days, and I even went and talked with some people and talked through the gospel. Maybe he doesn't remember, but I do. I made it a point whenever I could get out and share Christ with people, share what God was doing to do it. I have no idea. I'm not going to stand before you this morning and say X number of people have been saved through our ministry over the last 30 years in Australia, because I don't know. It's definitely in the high hundreds, if not thousands. It's not my job to count. I'll find out in glory. Until then, I keep serving and keep working and keep seeing what the Lord has. But people have come to Christ, and we have seen lives changed. Maybe you have great memories, and you remember that one of the first people that we led to the Lord was a rugby player who was a big guy, tough guy, who had life by the tail and didn't think he needed anything. And then when we got to really talking with him about life, his life, as he painted the picture, was great with others. As he painted the picture with his wife, was really tough. We started there. We all want a great marriage, right? Few of us get a great marriage. I am blessed. I can tell you, after 38 years, my wife and I still have not had a fight. Fabulous. I am so grateful for that. But I have been with so many people who said, no, we had one the first night, one the second night, one the third night. And that's their life. Well, this guy was so full of himself that it took a long time for him to begin to break down and understand that he doesn't get to set standards. And we were able to look at the standards for entering heaven being set by God. After all, it's his house, right? You walk into his house and it was his standards. Okay, that was what we ended up using. You walk into God's house, it's God's standards. Where is God's house? Heaven. You want to go to heaven? Then you're going to go by his standards. And we began there. Ate a lot of bananas with that guy. The guy was a fruitarian. You ever heard of a fruitarian? Only eats fruit and nuts. Ate a lot of bananas with that guy because I didn't want to eat meat in front of him. But yeah, he ended up growing in Christ and being trained and taught. And as we left that church, he was a deacon. God did great things in his life. I could talk of other people who were always arguing and always angry. I can talk about atheists who always had an answer, always had a quip, always had a way to come back at you and just put you down for believing in Christ. And yet they get close to the end of life or have a real life scare where they think they're going to die anytime, and then all of a sudden they're willing to talk about spiritual things. Been there. Talked with many, far too many, on their deathbed. One of the guys that I last led to Christ, who was a strong atheist, looked at me and said, "Why didn't you convince me of this years ago? This is bringing such peace into my life. I would have rather had the peace than all the turmoil." I tried. Where do you go from there? People coming to Christ has always been a point of our ministry. We're going to Tokyo with Pastor and Gabe and, 60 others? 61 others? And we are looking forward to being able to share Christ at those events. If you don't know, and I wouldn't expect you to know, we are now up to 8,1200 people that have been saved through the Olympic or the World Cup ministry that the pastor of the church they have joined has contacted us and said, yes, they're a solid believer, they're growing in Christ. 12,800, and you have had a part of that. Your giving, your prayers is what makes it available for us to be able to be out there and to travel and to go to those spots and to be able to share Christ with people. I'm so grateful that we're getting the opportunity so far, if COVID or some other dumb disease doesn't break out, that you're sending Pastor this time with us. We wish we'd have been able to be in Japan, brother, and share Christ there. We still had a number of people come to Christ from Japan, partly because our booklets, when we couldn't go, we had already paid for and printed the booklets. We gave them away to any church that fell within the evangelical spectrum. Literally paid for the shipping to them in Japan. And they distributed 54,800 booklets. And they were leading to Christ. Japanese, you know, one of the most unreached people groups in all of the world today is Japan. Yes, we went in there after the Second World War. Yes, we've had missionaries there for years, but the results have remained small for the population overall. If you looked at countries that really, really need the gospel today, Japan is high on that list because so many people haven't ever heard of Christ. It's been less than 2 months since I sat down at a table with Japanese and said, they've told me, "I've never ever read a Bible before. I've never touched one." And then to be able to share the gospel with them, what a wonderful thing. That was in Australia. They were down there as exchange students, and I met them at the university. But even in Japan, where we weren't able to be there, the gospel still went forward from that ministry. We are so grateful for it. In Paris, we have 85,000 books that we're ready to hand out, booklets. I left them at the house this morning. Some of you have seen them before. I was going to bring some this morning. The ones that we did for Japan, I don't have any of the Paris ones. They were printed in Paris. And I'll see them for the first time the same time I get there, you know. But they're already done. They're already printed. They're already waiting for us. We're excited about that. And So we'll go forward with that. In the passage here in Psalm 126, he's praying that the Lord would restore the fortunes of Zion. I don't think the psalmist is talking here about the riches they had during Solomon's day. I think they're talking about that close relationship with God, because the passage, as I read it, really isn't about money. It's about God doing some great things in this sowing and this reaping, not being just fields. They're not asking to be great farmers, but they're asking to see God bring in a harvest as they get involved in the work. Many people have grown to Christ and grown in their knowledge of God over the last 30 years. I am so grateful that that has been one of the mainstays of our ministry over 30 years, discipleship and seeing people grow in the Lord and seeing people trained in the Lord. Many of you know that we just completed a church plant. Did you know that the guy that is now the pastor of Living Hope Baptist Church had his very first opportunity ever to preach in our church? Some 6 years ago, he was thinking about the possibility of considering maybe seeing if God would someday, somehow, something, get him into ministry. You know how vague people can be. And we asked him if he wanted to find out what preaching was like and start working on a thing. And we worked with him to work up a sermon that was an appropriate sermon, a good sermon. And he preached it, and he disappeared, and we didn't see him because he went back to the church he was a member of, and we didn't see him for years. It was amazing to hear at his 30th birthday party recently that he remembered that very well. He had gone away and gotten Bible college training. He had gone away and gotten a good bit of experience in ministering to people and preaching more, yes. Now he's pastor of the church that first gave him an introduction to ministry. We are so, so grateful for the opportunity to train up Phil. He was associate pastor for, 7-8 months, and then he became full-time in January, and then after Easter, we resigned. I don't know how many of you have ever done a large move a distance away. Double that work if you're leaving the country. So it has taken us a lot of time to pack up and get ready to go. So we resigned after Easter, and we took a good share of May trying to finish things off, trying to wrap things up, trying to transfer responsibilities and all of that kind of thing. And then the 9th of June was our last Sunday there, and God was good in that. There was a lot of tears in that. He talks in verse 5, "For those who sow in tears shall reap with shouts of joy." One of the things that we said way back in 1992 when we were here was that God had called us to Australia to plant churches. We didn't know what that meant, because the best missionary that we had ever known that had gone to Australia had planted two churches. But we knew that God had called us to plant churches and not stay in one church. We're here done concluding that, having concluded that ministry today, to share with you the blessings that the Lord had us plant 7 churches. The longest serving missionary in Australian history with our board or other fundamental boards was 24 years. Until we came along. We just hit 30 years in Australia. God is so, so good. And yes, there was plenty, plenty of tears as we were leaving. You get to love a place, you know? You get to really love the people and the opportunities there. One of the dreams that we had not only was for us to start churches, but for the churches to be starting churches, the churches to be involved in starting the churches to be involved in carrying on those ministries. We've seen it from two different aspects in the time that we were in Australia. We've seen it from the churches starting from the very beginning, and us going in and doing Bible studies within the church and talking about what it takes to be a church planting church, and had them help us start a church with a pastor from the beginning. That was the most successful church plant that we ever had in Australia. This last one was different. We didn't have anybody ready to go yet to pastor the church. We had to train up more pastors before we were ready to go. And the churches came together at the end, the fellowship of churches that we belong to down there, and said, "You've done well. It's time for us as a fellowship of churches now to back somebody to pastor the church." And they are the ones carrying on in discipling him. The churches are, and they are the ones actually even covering a little bit of his support. The church wasn't capable of covering a... In Australia, because there is a ministers' union, I mean union, just like what you think of a union, this guy is not in the union, but the government still makes us pay union wages, whether we want to or not, and union benefits, whether we want to or not. And that starts at $75,000 a year. Our little church wasn't capable of that. And so a couple other churches in the fellowship said, "We'll make up the difference." Fantastic. They jumped in and they wanted to be part of that. Trust me, I didn't ever make that much money. I just wasn't employed by the church, is the way it looked on paper. But now that they have their own pastor, he's able to carry on and do that. He's got a house, a place to live, and a decent salary. He should do fine that way. But another blessing that we had, able to see the churches go from being focused on themselves to being gathered together in a fellowship of churches. There was no, this church is part of the CARBC, right? There was no equivalent. There was no fellowship of churches when we went 30 years ago. None. And we helped develop the fellowship of churches. We helped develop the churches cooperating and doing things together. We just had a Bible conference, and we ended up in a place that could seat 900, and we ran out of seats. Last year's conference, the same thing. We had a less known speaker this year. We thought we would be fine. Nope. God is so good. God is so good. We've seen the fellowship of churches even last calendar year, start their own mission board to be able to send missionaries. Not as a boast of me, but as a boast to the glory of God. You know where the first missionary came from? Our small little church plant. Now, does that feel good when you're training people up to serve the Lord, to have them head off on the mission field? Not really. But can you be excited about it? Can you say God is doing great things? Absolutely. God is a good God, and he does know what he is doing. So there's a few of the things that we've seen. Let's see. I need to go along on some of the other things that we've seen the Lord do. Many of you know that we taught scripture in the public schools. My wife taught for 25 years, was teaching kids in the public schools scripture classes. She still would have people come up to her in the mall and say, "You were my scripture teacher." And they've grown, and she doesn't recognize them at all anymore. But, oh, great, good, where, when? But they always remembered, what a blessing. I had the opportunity to do that for about 4 or 5 years, and my wife did it for 25 years. What a wonderful blessing of the many people. We ran into a couple the last Saturday of May who he is now a deacon at Fellowship Baptist Church in Blacktown. He literally came to Christ because my wife said to the children in scripture class, it's Easter Sunday this week. This is Australia. We celebrate Easter here. If you want to find out what Easter is really about, ask your parents to go visit a good church. This is the church I go to. We would welcome you there, and we'll share with you what Easter is about. And they showed up. They showed up. A couple from Laos. Not too many Christians in Laos. And yet they came to Christ that weekend. And we were so thrilled to be able to spend some time with them that last Saturday in May and rejoice in the things that God has done with them and seeing them grow spiritually. Let's see. Going down another one. Missionaries who were sent out to and are serving in different areas. We have been blessed to see God do some tremendous, tremendous things that way. I'll give you just, I'm trying to just hit some of the points of what God has done in the last 35 years. Australia is a country of decent wealth and prosperity. There's no doubt about that. When we tell people that we serve in Australia, people look at us sometimes like, why in the world are you a missionary to Australia? Well, because they need them. You know, when only about 4% of the country has any idea what the gospel is. Very few people in the country know what it takes to plant a church. I probably could count on my fingers and toes, and still have fingers and toes left, on the number of people I know in the country who actually know what it takes to plant a church. And I'm talking of all stripes, all stripes. But yet, God has seen fit to use our ministry and to use our discipling and to use our mentoring to see some guys who are really qualified in that. One of the people say, well, why didn't you stay for another one? There is a time when the teacher needs to step back so that those he has trained can actually do the work, because some people would rather work with a teacher than the student. Does that make sense? We've got a couple of guys who really need now to be the ones doing the next church plants. Not me. They need to be, because they're decades younger than me. They'll be there for the long term. If Barb and I did another church plant, we would be in our late 70s before we were done with that church plant. That's tough. That's hard. We're already starting to slow down. We're already feeling our age. We're already feeling it. When I look at the young people in university and know that they're younger than my children, and they look at me and they say, wow, how do you have such a knowledge of God, or how in the world could you have read the Bible through 50 times? My simple answer is, well, I'm old. We've had people inspired to serve in other ways, whether we're talking about Christian camps or preaching. I think last time we were here, we were talking about the group of 12 that we had that were taking a homiletics class to learn how to preach. And we had them preaching at our church while we were away. I'm excited to say that from that, two churches have been planted with a pastor from the beginning, and they divided into groups, and three guys stayed in the mother church, and the other nine guys split up into two groups and planted the other two churches. God is doing great things through people that we were able to mentor. We were able to be there and help them and train them and then step back while we came on furlough. When we came on furlough last time, we said, yes, sometimes it's important for us to step away. Otherwise, they get way too dependent on us. And that's exactly what was going on. Some of you maybe even thought, yeah, he's nuts. But we did know what we were talking about, and it did work for the glory of God. Not because we're good, but because God is good. Let's see. I could talk about men. I've got down here a few names of some men who have really been mentored in ministry. When I got to know probably my best friend in Australia, Irwan. Yes, it's an Indonesian name. It sounds like Irwan. Irwan, that's the way he tells people how to pronounce his name. when I got to know Irwan, he was fresh in the ministry, new and not really knowing, and comes from a background that was a fruit salad. And had a lot of things in his mind. And I said, well, first up, if you're going to be in ministry, we need to be praying together. So let's set aside a time every Thursday morning and let's pray. And we just got together and we talked about what was going on in ministry for sometimes an hour. And then we always prayed for a minimum of an hour, hour and a half, some days two. Because the Lord is good and we know the Lord has the answers. I'm so blessed to step back now and see as I leave. I was praying with Irwan right up until the week I left. Irwan's the one who has my car right now trying to sell it for me. you know anybody wants a right-hand drive Jeep? Irwan is now meeting with people, three different guys, every week, and teaching them the importance of prayer and ministry. Let's pray together, and God will work it out. We can talk about how he's going to work it out, but let's make sure that we're spending more time in prayer than we are in talking. Oh, so good. When Irwan had twins, and one of the boys they really did not think was going to make it, it was hours in prayer with Irwan. And that really touched us as well as touched their lives. I have 13 years now of aged care ministry. Retirement homes, is that what you think of? Wow, that's a place I want to go? It got to the point where I was almost even willing to say, well, if the Lord leads me here, maybe I'll move in. I got to loving the people and the staff there so much. During COVID, when nobody else was allowed in except staff and under very strict conditions, we were asked and in fact begged to go in to the aged care homes to continue to minister to the people. You know how many of them had questions seeing fellow residents die and their families not being able to even see them, not even being able to have a funeral? That's how bad it was in Australia. You know how many spiritual questions I have at those moments? Heaps. Some of you know I enjoy singing. And Barb enjoys even more than I do. You've heard me sing solos and what have you. I don't know. Yeah, years ago, I think we sang a few duets, a duet or two here. Barb sings more than I do. She definitely sings more than I do. But we would go in and we would just sing hymns with them. some days when they were really on edge and the fighting and the bickering inside the aged care home was getting extreme, would just go in and we would set up in the rec hall and sing hymns for 45 minutes. Every time we did that, the staff would call us later in the day and say, "Thank you, it's been so peaceful since." It's not me, it's not my singing voice, it's God's word going out in those songs. We were very careful what songs we picked. We wanted to proclaim Christ and the gospel. Yes, I'd read Bible verses in between the songs, but it was getting the gospel out through song that made the big difference there. We enjoyed that ministry so much. Yes, again, we cried when we said goodbye to them, knowing that my last message there, the last message I preached there, was about how God was preparing a place for us, those who believe in Him. And they and I would live in the same place. And we would be able to enjoy eternity forever, and we wouldn't have to worry about being apart and saying goodbye to each other and see you later and those kind of things. Aged care ministry. Oh, God blessed us with 13 years of aged care ministry. Let me not minimize it, because the next Psalm, 127, talks very much about raising children. We raised two children on the field to serve the Lord. Can I say, whether it was you personally or not, both of my children still are serving the Lord, but when we last were looking for a new sending church and we told our children that this was a possibility, both of my children said that was our favorite church of all of our churches. Orchard Avenue Baptist was our favorite church of all the churches. You helped in us raising our children to the glory of God, to continue to live and serve God. I was talking with Luke last night at midnight, and he says, "Yeah, I got to get to bed." He's in Texas. but he had just gotten off of work, and he says, "I got to get to bed. I got to run sound tomorrow morning for church, and my wife is singing in the worship team up front." It's like, "Oh, yeah, I better let you go to bed. I got to preach too." So, but they're active in serving the Lord, partly because of the input you had and the opportunity God gave us to raise them in a solid Christian atmosphere. We've been handed the ministry of sport event evangelism. Yes, Pastor and Gabe are coming with us to Paris. And there has been... Can I make a recommendation to you? Never do an international move and coordinate 63 people to go to a country that you don't live in, and a major ministry all at the same time. Barb and I are so looking forward to the next couple of weeks where we get to focus just on that ministry and making sure that we're ready for that. 63 people joining us in Paris. We're looking forward to it so much. We have people coming from 5 different nations, most, yes, from the U.S., but we have people coming from 5 different nations to be able to share the gospel in, well, we have the booklets printed in 6 different languages, but we have, I think, 7 different languages within the group that are spoken. Have I been here since I was in Qatar? I don't think I have. So the sport event evangelism targets the biggest sporting events of the world, the FIFA Men's World Cup, where you can get 5 million people, international visitors, show up. You know what it does when 5 million people descend on an area? It gives you lots of opportunities to talk with people from all over the world. There was only 6 of us that went to Qatar. Most people were really afraid of going to Qatar, and I understand. I fully understand. If you have tried to follow me on social media, you'll know I almost do nothing on social media anymore because I wanted to go to Qatar. And if you do anything on social media, think companies like Facebook share all that stuff with the government. So I even had to go through and delete scripture verses off of my Facebook and all of my Instagram posts and all of that kind of stuff. You might find a few up there that are archived, but I doubt it, because I had to get rid of that so I could get a visa into Qatar. We talked with people from 90 nations, six of us, 90 nations. Now, I know Esperanza over here has people from a number of different nations that go there. I met this morning probably at least a handful when I jumped in there before Sunday school. But in Paris, we honestly, literally expect it to be at least 190 nations. You want to know how to pray? Pray to the Lord of the harvest as he thrusts forth his labors into his harvest field. We will have the nations gathered together, not too unsimilar to Pentecost, even more nations than were at Pentecost. And as the gospel goes out, God can do great things. We're up to 23 churches that we know of that have started directly from the sport event evangelism since 1996. Is that a wonderful thing or what? I already said 12,800 people who the pastor has gotten back in touch with me said, yes, they're growing strong as disciples in the Lord. Wonderful stuff. And we have the opportunity to add to that. Last time we were in Europe, we had 900 people come to Christ at that event, during the event, and more after. I don't know what this time will bring. The Lord does. I'm looking forward to it. And we'll have wonderful opportunities just to get out and talk with people all day long. Some of you might think that would be wonderful. Some of you might think that would be very scary. We've got both in the group, okay? We got people who love talking with people from different parts of the world, and we got people who would be scared to death. But we've got a number of people who are going who are considering ministry. And if they're considering ministry, they really have to have a firm grip on how to share the gospel. This is a wonderful opportunity to do that, especially if they're considering missions, because they'll have the opportunity to talk with people from all over the world. Pray for us in Paris. Barb and I are the leaders of that, and we'll be doing this Olympics. We'll be doing the next one. Where's the next Olympics? L.A. I hope some of you, more than two, are going to come down to L.A. You don't have the excuses about Paris, okay? I'm hoping that some of you will come down to L.A. and we can have a great presence of our churches here in California converging on people from all over the world as they come to L.A. and share the gospel with people. You'll be able to talk with Pastor by then and Gabe, and they'll tell you, it's not scary. It's not bad. It's a lot of fun. We're in charge of that. The Olympics after L.A.? Anybody know where that's at? Brisbane, Australia. Guess what? I'm going to go home. No, we will we'll look forward to being leaders of that one as well. Get through a couple more, we should be done. Steady testimony in a community that otherwise would have no light. Do you live in a neighborhood where there's not another Christian within blocks? Some of you may. This is California. I get that. Okay? I'm about ready to go to Texas in Dallas area and find a place to live a rent for a bit. And I don't expect that will be the case there. But none of our neighbors were Christians. Yet we were a consistent source of light. We consistently were there in conversations with them about the gospel. We had a Jehovah's Witness move in who really was not a Christian. I had all kinds of weird ideas, not even standard Jehovah's Witness ideas, who was constantly trying to convert the neighborhood. And then they come over to me and say, Matt, that doesn't quite sound right. Yeah, let's talk about it. And I would be able to share with the neighbors about those things. We gave people the opportunity to have part of an effective ministry. Over the years in Australia, 30 years, we had 38 teams that visited us in Australia. You guys never sent a team down. We always wanted you to send a team down, but you never sent a team down to work with us. 38 teams in 30 years, plus the teams that we do for the international sporting event evangelism. So when people ask us, well, what are you going to do next? That's what we're going to do next, is we're going to work more in the area of construction, being the go-between between the missionaries and the contractors. Contractors and missionaries don't normally get along very well together. One is thinking all in the physical, and one is thinking mostly in the spiritual, and sometimes they don't get along as well, and we will be team specialists, as I think the label they have given us in all of that, because I understand building, okay? I just do. I enjoy it. Sometimes it's more productive than talking with people. I can see results at the end of the day. But I also understand the missionary's heart. So that's where we're heading in the days ahead. We will be working with places that are known for their evangelism. Go Construction, the group that we will be under ABWE, is all about going to the places that are already effective, and if they had better buildings or better something built for them, would be able to expand that. Whether it be a medical clinic that's just a one room, small little thing. But now, the end of this year, we're going to start construction in Papua New Guinea on a operating theater and three offices or exam rooms and two stay overnight bed kind of mini hospital medical center up in Goroka, because they are sharing the gospel and seeing about 200 people a year come to Christ. Well, if they have the doctors, but they have to only share a one room, I'll call it a shack, okay? You go buy a Tough Sheds. It's built better than this thing is. And now we're going to go in and be able to build them the medical center. They're paying for it, yes, but we're going to be able to get the work done for them and be able to see that go forward. I got some good stories for you on that one if you want to talk more about some of that kind of stuff, what's going on, but I'm going way too long. God has done some good things. 12 years of the Focus Ministry, talking to university students on the international students on the campus. Loved it. God led. So this year alone, this calendar year, we've seen 7 students from what you would consider closed countries come to Christ through that ministry. This calendar year alone, God is doing such wonderful things there. We could talk about ESL and so much more. We really appreciate you being part of this ministry now for a long time, for a very long time. You have blessed us. You have blessed our family. Thank you. Thank you. What you have sown in tears and praying for us has reaped a harvest. We have joined you in those tears at times, praying for the Lord of the harvest to do his work, and we have seen him do great things. This is just a praise to God. Thank you for coming this morning, and we'll talk more as we have the opportunity, all right? God, thank you so much for the time we've had together. Be glorified. Be blessed. It's not about me. It's about you and your work and your way. Continue to build your kingdom, and we'll continue to praise and thank you and seek how you would have us to be a part. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.